Many of the people interested in the human exploration of space are ready to accept the idea that sooner or later we can go to Mars to build a permanent base and even large settlements. But to the same people, the prospect of transforming the planet's environment to adapt it to the needs of us on Earth seems instead pure fantasy, or at best, technological challenge to be projected into a very distant future. But are things really like that? A point of view, that of these people, completely shared and worthy of respect. But, although it is currently a cold, dry, and probably lifeless planet, according to many other experts, Mars has all the elements necessary to sustain life. Water, carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen. Not to mention that several of its physical characteristics, such as gravity, rotational speed, and axial tilt, are virtually identical to those of the Earth, and make it the ideal candidate for a future terraforming attempt. The concept of global modification of a hostile planetary environment to make it habitable is due to the literary inventiveness of William Olaf Stapledon, 1886 to 1950, an English writer known above all for his science fiction novels. In fact, it is mentioned for the first time in his 1930 novel, Last and First Men, a monumental fresco which has recently also become a movie, which tells of humanity's space epic over 2 billion years. And in which it is said, among other things, that to purify Neptune's poisoned atmosphere and make it breathable, humans released genetically modified plants on its surface, capable of absorbing harmful molecules and injecting those of oxygen in their place. 10 years later, in a short story entitled Collision Ship and published in 1942, the American writer Jack Williamson, 1908 to 2006, baptized the same concept with the term terraforming, that is, the set of operations necessary to transform a planet into another Earth. For several years, terraforming was considered a typical narrative device of science fiction, on a par with hyperspace travel. But scientists soon started talking about it too. The first to do so was the famous American astronomer Carl Sagan, 1934 to 1996, who in 1961 proposed a way to make the planet Venus more welcoming to hypothetical terrestrial colonizers. Venus, as we well know, is a real hell. On the surface, the temperature is about 460 degrees centigrade, and the atmospheric pressure is 92 times that of the Earth, which is like being here on Earth under 1,000 meters of water. Any organism deposited on the surface of Venus is then immediately roasted and crushed, and the Soviet Venera probes know something about it. The high temperature is due to a large amount of greenhouse gases present in the Venusian atmosphere, CO2 and water vapor. Sagan's idea was therefore to seed the atmosphere of Venus with algae of the genus Nastocaceae, which thanks to their photosynthetic activity would have absorbed CO2 and produced carbohydrates, releasing oxygen as a bonus. Although attractive, this scenario would not have had much chance of leading to a radical transformation of the climate of Venus, as Sagan wrote the article when the prohibitive value of atmospheric pressure was not yet known, which he estimated at only 4 bars. The 1970s were the years in which the concept of terraforming began to circulate extensively in scientific circles. During that time, several articles were written and the first conferences were held. In the context of more conservative scientific groups, the term was still considered non-serious and speculative. But now, it was no longer just science fiction writers and eccentric scientists like Sagan who wrote on the subject. The idea of being able to change the face of another planet had now made its way, and immediately it was applied to Mars, which to many seemed much more promising than Venus. Even Mars is nowadays a decidedly hostile planet to life. It is very cold, minus 53 centigrade on average, with excursions between minus 140 degrees centigrade and plus 20 degrees centigrade. Its atmospheric pressure is very low, 6% than the terrestrial one. On the surface, there is never water in a liquid state except in very particular conditions, and the atmosphere is unbreathable for a man, 96% CO2. Also, the surface is constantly bombarded by cosmic and ultraviolet rays, radiations that make life almost impossible to establish. So why is it believed that Mars is the most suitable planet for early terraforming? The main reason is that according to what we know today, the red planet is the only one on which liquid water once flowed. It is also likely that it even possessed a large ocean in the northern hemisphere, a dense atmosphere composed mainly of carbon dioxide and significant quantities of water in lakes and rivers. These conditions are assumed to have existed in the first billion years of the solar system. Subsequently, for still partially unknown causes, there was a gradual absorption of the atmosphere into the soil and a partial dispersion into space. The atmosphere became so thin that a self-reinforcing cooling phase began for the planet. To bring Mars back to life, according to some, it will only take him back to his youth. Scientists are in fact in agreement on the fact that the first level of terraforming can be said to be reached when 1. The atmospheric mass is increased to significantly reduce the amount of radiation reaching the ground. 2. Liquid water will be available on the surface. 3. The ground temperature will be increased by about 60 degrees. In practice, when the conditions of Mars will resemble those of the Earth, in the pre-Cambrian period, a complete and autonomous biosphere capable of supporting the life of anaerobic microorganisms. To arrive at this scenario, the first step will be to increase the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere to exploit the greenhouse effect. This will cause a gradual rise in temperature and set off a chain reaction. But where to find the necessary CO2? The Martian atmosphere contains quite a lot of it, but it is still too small a quantity to do its role well. It will therefore be necessary to find a way to use that frozen in the polar caps and the Martian regolith. It has in fact been calculated that the caps would contain enough CO2 to bring the pressure from the current 6 mbar up to 100 mbar, while the reserves contained in the regolith, which exist above all at high latitudes, would allow a final pressure of 400 to 500 mbar to be reached. But are we really sure? These calculations are based on the most optimistic forecasts, but in reality, we do not know how much carbon dioxide reserves really are. And it is in this statement that one of the most serious weaknesses of the terraforming of Mars lies. If too much of that primal atmosphere has been lost in space, recreating it will be very difficult. Conversely, if most of it has been absorbed by the regolith or frozen in the polar ice caps, recreation will be much easier. If the predictions are wrong, and Mars doesn't have enough CO2 to inject into the atmosphere, the task will become particularly complicated. And this is not just a hypothesis. In 2004, for example, the European Mars Express orbiter discovered that, contrary to what was previously thought, the southern polar ice cap is mostly made up of frozen water. And that carbon dioxide would only be found in a surface layer 10 meters thick. If this were the case, its total sublimation would raise the pressure by only 0.36 mbar, or about 5% of the current atmospheric pressure. It is also possible, however, that most of the CO2 is found elsewhere, and that it is chemically bound in carbonates as on Earth. On our planet, CO2 trapped in marine carbonates returns to the atmosphere thanks to volcanic activity. On Mars, it will be necessary to vaporize these carbonates using particularly destructive means, which will have important consequences on the planetary environment, such as nuclear explosions and asteroid impacts. On the other hand, reassuring data on the consistency of CO2 deposits in the caps come from the fact that, in a Martian year, atmospheric pressure can increase by 20% when the polar ice cap melts under the sun's rays in spring. And CO2 changes from a solid to a gaseous state, sublimation. Likewise, atmospheric pressure drops by 20% as gaseous atmospheric CO2 condenses to return to a solid state in the shells during the winter, which is certainly not a small thing, since all this happens most naturally. If man can initiate a similar process, then the system should self-sustain itself according to this mechanism. By starting the melting of the south polar cap, a small amount of CO2 will be released, which will contribute to increased atmospheric pressure and produce a greenhouse effect. The heat released will in turn act on the polar cap, which will release more gases, causing a further increase in the greenhouse effect, and so on. According to the calculations, in fact, an increase in the temperature of the south polar cap of only 4 degrees centigrade would be enough to start the process. All good in theory, but how to do it in practice? The choice of the best method to trigger the greenhouse effect just described is a problem on which there is a great divergence of opinions among scientists. and therefore many different projects are being studied. It should also be stressed that none of the technologies set out below are fully available today, but some believe it is reasonable to think that some will be by the end of the century at the latest. We are therefore not leaving the scientific method for the world of fantasy, but speculating on the near future of a young science still in formation. We should not be surprised, then, by the audacity of projects such as that of the English astronomer Paul Birch, who to start the Martian greenhouse effect proposed to build a mirror with a radius of 125 kilometers capable of reflecting sunlight towards the South Martian pole to raise its temperature by at least 4 degrees centigrade, enough to make the carbon dioxide trapped there in the form of dry ice gaseous again. The mirror, if positioned on the zenith of the South Pole at 214,000 kilometers from the planet, not in orbit, but the so-called pole sitter position, perpendicular to the polar axis of the planet kept in place by the balance between the force of gravity and the thrust of sunlight, could heat the spherical cap of the planet from 70 degrees of latitude. The huge mirror should be built in 4 microns thick mylar fabric, like a solar sail, and coated with aluminum for a total of 200,000 tons. The size and weight of such an object makes its construction on Earth completely unthinkable, so to make it, you will have to wait until you have mining and manufacturing facilities in space, perhaps on the moon. And given how the preparations are in full swing for a new moon race, full of new protagonists, Chinese, Japanese, Indian, European, private companies, we may not have to wait too long. However, carbon dioxide is not the only greenhouse gas, nor the most efficient. There is, for example, the large family of chlorofluorocarbons, CFCs, outlawed in the 1980s because they were recognized as responsible for the ozone hole that hit the atmosphere above Antarctica. CFCs, as greenhouse gases, are much more efficient than carbon dioxide, and thanks to them, the planetary greenhouse effect could be triggered in just 20 years, even if at costs that are currently impossible, because it would require the construction of factories for the production of CFCs directly on Martian soil. The industrial effort would be considerable and would probably require the support of a work team of several hundred people, and it is therefore unlikely that such an operation could be carried out before the middle of the 22nd century. In the first part of this discussion, we talked about the origins of the concept of terraforming and the need, in the case of Mars, to start a warming process by releasing the carbon dioxide trapped in the polar ice. In this second part, we will review the methods proposed to do so, concluding with an analysis of the actual feasibility of the operation. Another way to raise the temperature of the polar ice cap could be to sprinkle it with a black powdery substance, coal dust. This would reduce the amount of sunlight reflected by the ice caps into space and result in consequent heating of the ice. According to a NASA study, this way the caps could be fully vaporized in a couple of centuries. Yes, but where to find this black powder? Some say sending it from Phobos and Deimos, which are among the blackest bodies in the solar system, or introducing dark, extremophilic microbial life forms such as lichens, algae, and bacteria. However, Mars is already the second darkest planet in the solar system, absorbing more than 70% of the incoming sunlight, so the space to darken it further is small. And dig thousands of tons of dark regolith on Phobos and then spread it on the ice. This too must not be a joke. Not to mention even crazier proposals such as triggering nuclear reactions inside Phobos to turn it into a small star, or to detonate nuclear bombs in the craters of ancient volcanoes to make them active again, or to change the orbit of some asteroids to make them fall on the polar caps. And speaking of bizarre and dangerous ideas, Elon Musk proposed bombarding the poles of Mars with hundreds of atomic bombs to release all the CO2 contained, a proposal that fortunately NASA promptly rejected, proving that to obtain some result would require thousands of explosions a day. In short, the ideas to awaken the planet by raising the temperature are there, it is true, but the fact remains that these are projects that at the moment are all far beyond our technological possibilities, and that probably will still be for several centuries. Terraforming a planet like Mars also requires knowledge in climatology and planetology that we are far from having. Man today is unable to control the Earth's climate, and we must admit that we suffer from it much more than we control it. The Red Planet is also plagued by two major handicaps that could ruin any terraforming effort. Mars is a small planet, has just 1/10 the mass of the Earth, and its gravitational field has proved unable to prevent a significant portion of its precious atmosphere from escaping into space. even managing to form a dense atmosphere at the right point, the problem will then be to be able to hold it back. Unlike the Earth then, Mars no longer has a global magnetic field. The dynamo effect has in fact ceased with the rapid cooling of the metal core, in turn linked to the small size of the planet. On Earth, this magnetic field forms a shield that protects the atmosphere from the abrasive effects of the solar wind. Despite their genius, pessimists say humans will never be able to reactivate the Martian magnetic field, even if it is a study in which Jim Green, director of NASA Planetary Science Division, proposes to place a magnetic shield dipolar at the Lagrange point L1 of Mars to create an artificial magnetosphere around the planet. And the planet will never again be able to rely on this formidable natural umbrella to prevent the erosion of its atmosphere. Faced with the absence of a global magnetic field and the weakness of gravity, man will probably have to surrender forever. A very harsh sentence, this. But for the sake of argument, let's assume that we have somehow managed to trigger the greenhouse effect on Mars, increasing the atmospheric pressure to at least 1/10 of that of Earth and allowing the water to form pools here and there. What should be the next step? Well, at that point, if we ever get there, the plan is to rely on infantry, that is, on bacteria. Microorganisms seem to be the ideal actors for the terraforming of the red planet. As on Earth, they could release ammonia or methane, gases that are much more efficient from the point of view of the greenhouse effect than carbon dioxide. Laboratory simulations have already shown that some species of methogenic bacteria can cope with reduced atmospheric pressure and find the nutrients necessary for their survival in the Martian soil. Planetary engineers will also be able to exploit the formidable resilience of the bacterium Deinococcus radiodurans. This microorganism can survive doses of radiation 3,000 times higher than those that would kill a human, and also has a high tolerance to drying. If 1% of the planet is covered with bacteria, and their efficiency in converting solar energy into a chemical compound is 0.1%, 1 billion tons of methane and ammonia will be produced annually, and this will raise the temperature 10 degrees Celsius every 30 years. Moreover, the methane and ammonia produced by their metabolism will also provide good protection against UV rays. Once this stage is reached, the benefits for future settlers will already be very significant. The next step towards total terraforming will consist of the radical transformation of the atmosphere, introducing oxygen and nitrogen, and eliminating carbon dioxide. This is the well-known process of chlorophyll photosynthesis, thanks to which the plants of the Earth supply oxygen to the animal world. To increase the oxygen content of the Martian atmosphere, we can disseminate cyanobacteria on the surface of Mars, used to living in extreme conditions such as in Antarctica. Cyanobacteria are among the first living things on our planet. For 2 billion years, these organisms reigned supreme on the surface of our planet and profoundly changed the composition of the Earth's atmosphere. Well, by capturing CO2 and releasing oxygen through their photosynthetic activity, they can also gradually change the composition of the Martian atmosphere. Why not? Two particularly resistant cyanobacteria species have attracted the attention of scientists. The first, Crucosidiopsis, is a cyanobacterium capable of tolerating extreme drought, high salinity, as well as significant temperature contrasts. On Earth, Crucosidiopsis lives in deserts buried a few millimeters on the surface of translucent rocks, sandstones, which then play a role of a moisture trap and ultraviolet shield. The second species, Matia, is a drying-resistant cyanobacterium that has the property of dissolving carbonate rocks to find protection. Matia is also able to fix atmospheric nitrogen if this compound is scarce in its environment. Whatever species of algae are selected for terraforming, they must first bring the oxygen partial pressure to the threshold value of 1 mbar. At that time, higher plants will be able to develop freely on the surface of Mars. These plants, made more efficient thanks to genetic engineering, will be acclimated to the harsh Martian conditions and will produce even more oxygen. So the partial pressure will eventually exceed 120 mbar. The amount of oxygen will then be enough for the first Martians to leave their respirators in the locker room before going out. Within several decades, using such an approach, Mars could be transformed from its current dry and icy state into a warm, slightly humid planet capable of supporting life. The air would not yet be breathable for humans, but they would no longer need spacesuits and instead could travel freely outdoors, wearing ordinary clothes and using a simple respirator. Large habitable areas could also be built under huge inflatable domes containing breathable air, while simple, hardy plants could thrive in CO2-rich soil and spread rapidly across the surface. Over the centuries, these plants would bring more and more oxygen into the atmosphere, favoring the growth of more complex plants and the presence of an increasing number of types of animals. These are not just hypotheses. It was discovered that terrestrial lichens located inside the Mars Simulation Laboratory of the German Aerospace Center survived exposed to environmental conditions. And they did so by clinging to the cracks in the rocks and empty spaces of the simulated Martian soil, adapting and demonstrating the same activity they would have done in their natural environment. Could it therefore be that the best way to think about the terraforming of Mars is through the intensive use of microorganisms and elementary plants, perhaps genetically modified, rather than through the brutal planetary upheavals? Be that as it may, a terraforming discussion would be incomplete without the question, should we do it? Just because terraforming is technically possible and would not directly destroy an ecosystem does not mean that it must necessarily be done. Mars is beautiful and interesting as it is, and perhaps we should leave it this way to allow future generations to study it. The billion-year-old Martian landscapes tell the story of Mars and the solar system to anyone who can read them, and their destruction would be a terrible loss to science. The icy beauty of its deserts must be preserved. There is also the risk of biological contamination. If there is microbial life on Mars, the arrival of terrestrial organisms or the upheaval of the Martian environment by us could lead to their disappearance. And even if the absence of life were proven, some argue that the rocks and the shape of the landscape itself have an intrinsic value. This is an extreme view called cosmic preservationism. In this, the anthropocentrists are obviously much more hasty, for whom everything that man needs is good. From this point of view, the terraforming of Mars remains acceptable as long as it is in the service of man. Despite these questions, the terraforming of Mars could be an inevitable event in human history. Our planet, the Earth, is fragile and isolated. A cosmic catastrophe such as an asteroid impact could wipe out humanity and its history in seconds. Isn't man's goal to explore, discover new worlds, settle there, and thrive? Mars is a new world, a new frontier, a starting point for a new humanity. According to Carl Sagan, terraforming should not be a response to the overpopulation affecting our planet. The ticket for a one-way trip from Earth to Mars is too expensive. It also makes the same point about mineral resources. Transporting them to Earth would be too expensive. The ethical problems posed by terraforming are innumerable. But one thing is certain, a drastic change in the conditions governing Mars' surfaces could be undertaken with 22nd century technologies. Will man want to change the face of Mars? The question remains open.